Theo is a recovering Unix engineer with 20 years of work experience in telecom. He is also a university student for life. Calls himself an ML engineer, as he expresses through this role his passions for system engineering and machine learning. You hear my daughter doing harmonies in the background? Got a lot to get into. I'm gonna hand it over to you now, Theo. And for the record, Theo, I think you got a shirt that I sent you, right? You are one of those people. I sent over a shirt. Where is it? I made you go and get it out of the dirty clothes. Yes. How do you like that shirt?
Thanks. Tell us all. I won it, actually, right? It was a debate. Yes.
We should give the full story.
Demetrios, it's very it's very hard to hear you.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, it's because my thing's all low, huh? Could you hear? You couldn't hear me singing, man?
Oh no.
Well, yeah, I had that to put to make it very loud.
All right. Well,
that's better.
Let's just take a moment to welcome Theo and Alexey. Thank you both for being here. I'm really excited. Theo's going to go over the KFServe. You're also going to do some stuff with Kibana. You're going to talk about fairness that they added to KFServe. You're going to talk about a little monitoring. There's so much stuff that's going on. First, though, Theo, what happened? Why is it KFServe now?
Right. So like most of the projects in Kubeflow, there is a lot of growth. And because of that growth, the community wanted to get more experienced executives to support the growth of an open source project. And the vision is to go towards joining a large community like the Linux Foundation to help us with this. So what happened is that eventually KServe got out of the Kubeflow organization to be an autonomous organization. And that's the only change that happened in the GitHub space. And the team is now looking at filling up all the checklist in order to join the new organization. But for now, the important change is that the name has been changed, and the project has graduated from the Kubeflow organization. It's the first project that is graduating, actually.
Excellent.
But of course, that doesn't mean that KFServing, or now the new name is KServe, it doesn't mean that it's no longer part of Kubeflow as a distribution, right? So every vendor that is distributing Kubeflow, like AWS or Google or Azure, they still deliver also KServe on top of it.
Can I also ask a question?
Yeah, Alexey, sure. That's what you're here for, man. Yes. Come on, ask away.
The question that I think many people are now wondering, okay, now KFServing is KServe. What happens with Istio? Is Istio still there or not? Like, can we run KServing without Istio?
So I have good news for you. You can now. You can run KServe without Istio and without Knative. There is a lightweight version of it, a parallel version of KServe that you can deploy without all the heavy systems underneath it. So Istio and Knative are still available there, and we will still keep working on extending it as part of using it for security, for monitoring, for all this heavy infrastructure stuff. But if someone wants to practice or play in a small deployment in the infrastructure without having the Istio and Knative, because maybe it doesn't make sense for a lab to have monitoring and have such great infrastructure, yes, you can also use it without the Istio and Knative.
Interesting. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of people are very happy about that one. And I'm sure it wasn't easy to make that happen either.
Well, I value what the service mesh brings to KServe. Yeah. So I like that I can have a routing taking care for me instead of me having to worry about it. I like that I have tools on top of it, like Kiali, to be able to see how the routing goes across the microservices. Because don't forget, the inference service of KServe is a microservice. Yeah, it's a microservice that is serving a model, is a microservice that is doing some transformation. Maybe you can have a lot of microservices with a lot of models, and you eventually have what we call now the model mesh, which is a collection of models that they cooperate, and you essentially build eventually an inference graph of having your requests going across different models and reducing back the result.
Yeah.
I remember there was a discussion in MLOps Slack that like, how do you handle Kubeflow? And somebody commented that it's Istio, it's always Istio.
Yes. So Kubeflow will keep having Istio deployed, and all the services that want to consume it or be available through a gateway, instead of having to worry about the specifics of a specific cloud provider, for example, the API gateway of Amazon, you can just use Istio with a bare native load balancer of the cloud provider. So Istio is actually abstracting all these API gateway type of services from your cloud provider with the ingress gateway of Istio.
That's cool. Mm-hmm.
So all security and logging and things like that can be offloaded to a generic component like the ingress gateway. So we did have this session last year ago, and we did discuss.
Yeah, we should probably talk about exactly like the reason for this session that we're doing right now is because we did a lot of theory last session a year ago, and now we want to bring the practical part to this. So you're going to show us a bunch of actual coding and all that good stuff. And Alexey is going to ask as many questions as he can as you go through this without hopefully you...
the dumb data scientist who has no clue what's going on. Which is actually not far from true.
Keep in mind that if some of the questions can be answered by the video that we have uploaded in the MLOps community space from last year, we can refer to it, right? So
yeah.
Instead of going through the slides, we can just focus on the code or in what's happening in the Kubernetes platform.
Awesome. Yeah, let's do that. So do you want to share your screen and let's start launching it? And what are you going to walk through? What's like the overview of what you're going to do?
So I will just make sure that I'm not going to use a lot of tools. I'm going to work only with my PyCharm and the tools that PyCharm is offering me, and I will only load from my browser Kibana just to see the logs of the traffic. Yeah, and remember that I have here in my PyCharm loaded the KServe library, the KServe repository, and a small tutorial repository I created yesterday to be prepared for the session today. And I did also prepare some tests to be able to invoke my models and see the results in my infrastructure. So just to give you a quick overview of the tooling, here I have my repositories. In the services here, I have a kind cluster running on my local Docker for desktop. And in this kind cluster, I have just used the quick start script of the repository to install KServe. And then on top of this KServe, I'm running some some models. So if I go to the default namespace, I have some pods running that are the models that I instantiated. And these models are defined as inference service in terms of KServe, like we have discussed it last year extensively. On usually data scientists can invoke them using the SDK, the Python SDK, or the ML engineers can use the kubectl command to start it. And that's what I really did. I just started all these sample models that we have in the KServe repository to be able to invoke them with my tests and see the results. Yeah, I'm also running a TensorFlow server in my Docker, so I will be able to quickly look at the simple TensorFlow concept, because I did have this MNIST image which is based on the pixel values here. And just wanted to remind everyone that the concept of inference is that I'm sending a payload with an instance, for example, or multiple instances, and I'm getting back an answer, the predictions. And this instance can be a digit in the case of an MNIST dataset. Is that clear, or should I explain also the floating thing here with the floating point values that we see?
No, it's pretty clear to me. So yeah, basically what you have is you deployed already a model that classifies 100 in digits. You have a model that you trained with TensorFlow and you deployed with TensorFlow serving that you run locally with Docker, right? And then you also have, as I understood, you have KServe also running locally with a bunch of things. I don't remember which ones.
Yes. And actually, we can quickly go through this. If you remember from the TensorFlow website, we can download quickly the we can just get the code of a simple model, this MNIST model that I have loaded and load it in my in a Python file. And what I like in PyCharm is that I can just do things like that. So I can run this as a block of code, like I'm doing in a Jupyter notebook. So by appending this comment, I can consider this a block, and it's just quickly doing a training of a model with a couple of layers, and the input is 28 by 28 pixels, and the output is the 10 different classes that we know, and I just train the model. And what I can do as a data scientist, then I can just save this model. I can say model save to my MNIST directory here and give a version number. So if I'll do model save 2 and play it, it will create a subdirectory here. Let me refresh. Yeah, it should have created the directory. Maybe I'm talking. So to see it. Yeah, so it has a directory number 2 with a saved model which has the architecture definition and the variables which have the weights and the biases, as we have seen last year, and we shouldn't go through this. Of course, I like also this that I can just do in my Python console. I have what I executed, I also have these variables, so I can see the variables. Yeah, I like that I can go to the X test that I have loaded and see this is an array of 28 by 28 arrays. Oh, nice. I can also see this array as a, how to say, as color. Yeah, so I can see that this is digit 7, for example, if you can see like that. Yeah, so the floating point values refer to the pixel color in the or the gray. In the picture, but let's not go through that. That's what we see. It's serialized from that X test, for example, 00. It's serialized here in this as an instance in a JSON object, and usually we send it to with an HTTP request or a gRPC request. So this is what I'm doing. This MNIST JSON file is the serialized file of this, and we send it as a JSON payload to the model. And here, if you notice, I'm using the predict. Yeah, we have also discussed it last year. You can also send something else there. You can say explain in order to get an explanation of why this digit is a 7, is considered 7. Yeah, and we will see this later. Other than that, you can also load TensorFlow. Other than TensorFlow, you can also load PyTorch server, which is called Torch server nowadays, or an ML server for scikit-learn or XGBoost. And then the model, what we call the model server, in that case is TensorFlow serving, is offering also metrics. So model server metrics that you can see, like how much is the latency, the runtime latency in buckets that you can quickly consume in Prometheus and have nice histograms of your latency. Or you can have things like how much time that did take for the graph to load. Yeah, for example, to copy this the weights of the neural network from the CPU memory to the GPU memory and things like that. It's a nice thing that you can also do what we call the model metrics, the model server metrics. Yes, because we will see in terms of monitoring also the service metrics later. And now let's enter the world of KServe or KFServing. In the past, we have also an example of TensorFlow. Here I have deployed it using this inference service, let me find it, called flower sample from the sample directory. And the data scientist just providing one argument. What is the location in my cloud provider, in my S3 bucket, my Google storage, with a model that contains this structure, the versions. And then what the K service is doing is, by giving a name to it, is returning to you a URL. So if I do get ISVC, if I get my inference services, I will see that I've got back a flower sample URL. Yeah. And this is the URL that I'm posting things to. Yeah. Actually, I'm posting it to localhost, but I'm using the host header. Yeah. And by using this input that I have serialized in Base64 in that case, I'm getting back a prediction. Let me do this. I'm getting back a prediction with a scores and the prediction, whatever is this, what was the flower sample. Similarly, if I want to have another and a custom model of TensorFlow with the MNIST that we have loaded earlier in the Docker, I can do it. I'll get the same results in really fast. And if I don't want to use TensorFlow and I want to use PyTorch, the format of the definition in my models here would be that as a predictor, I'm going to use PyTorch instead of TensorFlow. So,
did I understand correctly that, let's say, if we have TensorFlow, so we always have predictor, and then we do predictor, and then we select if our model is TensorFlow, then we do predictor, TensorFlow, and then we provide a path to this model.
Yes, let's look at this. Thanks, Alexey. That's thanks for saying. You can either have transformer, explainer, or predictor here in the spec. Yeah, if I will delete this, I'll delete this and I will ask my UI to recommend what I can use. It's using the Kubernetes connection to get the docs strings and the custom resource definition in order to know what I can use. And then I just use control space in my case to see what are the things I can use here. So I can use TensorFlow or PyTorch or other things. Yeah.
What are the other things?
I can use the scikit-learn, XGBoost,
LightGBM.
Yeah, Padlet is a new library from
Overhead is also a library, or what is that?
Which one?
Overhead. I just don't know what it
is. I don't know this, but let's try to see what is the definition. No, sorry.
Okay, so basically, whatever kind of model we have, it's probably there, and we just select one of them, right? If it's TensorFlow, we just select TensorFlow.
Right.
And then we provide a path to the URL. And I think you mentioned that it should also follow this structure, that it has to have folders like one, two, and so on, right? Like
yes, in the case of TensorFlow serving. Of course, in the case of TorchServe, it has a different structure because it's using the MAR file, the archive format, of the model archive. Yeah. And I want to quickly go through this, just execute it, so that I'm getting the same type of response, maybe with different format. So I'm getting a prediction for this MNIST digit that I have loaded. And similarly with scikit-learn or XGBoost or whatever model server model format you want to use, there is a model server behind it. So for scikit-learn and XGBoost, there is a model server called ML server. Yeah. But instead of the data scientist having to know that I can use TensorFlow serving, I can use TorchServe, I can use ML server, it's abstracted. It's a facade for them. So you can just say, here is my definition. I want a TensorFlow predictor and let KServe figure out what model server they can use. Yeah. And actually, in the past, for PyTorch, we were using another custom predictor. And when this has when the TorchServe was published last year by PyTorch, we have changed it in the back, and this immediately became available to users as the new way of using it. So we keep discussing about the model servers. And the next thing I have in my list.
I have a question. So I'm really curious about this. So you send a post request to localhost, but then you also provide the host header. So what's going on here?
Oh yes, no. So this is the HTTP 1.1 specification that you can have multiple websites, what called virtual hosts behind the web server, right? So instead of having a different IP or different web server of your websites, you can use the host header of the HTTP protocol to define this particular virtual host. And so since every model is deployed as an inference service, and then every inference service is a microservice, is exposed to an HTTP request through an HTTP web server, and we are using this technology called virtual hosting.
So it kind of replaces localhost 8080 with this TorchServe default example.com.
Yes, because I do not have control over this example.com. Yeah, but if I would have my domain, let's say theo.nl, and instead of using this, I could just put it directly here, because let's say I could control theo.nl, so I would have my model being served through this address.
Mm-hmm. Then you don't need to specify the host, right?
Yes, right.
Mm-hmm. And just to remind us, so I think where do we get the host? I think you showed us briefly, you did kubectl, this thing.
Yes, I'm using the kubectl command. I have it an alias as k, and there is this inference service. Yeah, but if you are using the Python SDK, when you invoke it, you get back a result with a URL. But if you are a command line guy like me, you can do it with kubectl, kubectl, and get back the list of your inference services and their state.
Okay, thank you.
I'll speed up to go to the a little bit through the explainers, fairness, and robustness, because these are things that the trusted AI project or community of Linux Foundation for AI and Data have created, together with people from other organizations, like from Seldon. In that case, we have the Alibi. And they are offered us extra things next to the model. I have in the KServing repository, I have a nice diagram that is explaining this. If you remember from last year, you can have the design is that you have a transformer usually in front of your models. Yeah, so you can do the transformations, for example, from base64 to NumPy array of integers or floats, and send it to explainer to do, sorry, and send it to the predictor to do exactly what the predictor is supposed to do, and do the matrix multiplication between the X and the W, right, in the GPU memory. So it can only focus on that and do no transformations and connect to no other outside resources with a lot of I/O and et cetera. And so the introduction of explainer pattern here is that next to your predictor, you can also change the verb of your URL. And instead of sending a predict request, you can send an explain request to the same address. But in that case, it will go to another microservice that is offered by these vendors, like the Alibi from Seldon or the explainers from Trusted AI, to perform these explanations. And we can go through them quickly to look at how they look like. The first one I have is from the Fairness Toolbox, the Fairness AI F360. There's an example called German credit that was, if you notice here, instead of using predict, I'm using the explain verb. Yeah. So it will go to this model endpoint, to this inference service, but instead of invoking the predict function, to invoke the explain function, the explain component. And if I will do that, I will get back the results in that case, the fairness 360 is touching the area of discrimination, whether this particular model that is giving credit to someone who is requesting a loan is discriminatory or not. So it's having the concept of the disparate impact. It's one of the lot of metrics and a lot of algorithms that they have in place with this toolbox in order to support the data scientists who want to get explanations for their model. Similarly, with the alibi explainer, for example, from Seldon, you can get back the. I'm getting these examples from the samples directory of KServe. This comes with some. Let me see, what is the model? Alibi. So alibi is using the anchor tabular explainer, which is actually, you can have anchor tabular or anchor images or anchor text. And the anchor concept is that it's telling you which are the features that are more important for this decision. And in that case, the prediction for whether the income prediction model is popular, it's from a university that predicts whether the income of someone based on the information that you provide here will be more or less than 50,000. And the prediction is zero, and the explanation is that because they are never married and the occupation is this. So this is something that you can use in order to identify which is the feature importance. And imagine that all these explainers like fairness or just explanations cannot, people are thinking that they can be used because now with the new EU regulation, they can be used in order to be compliant when you deploy models with the legislation. But it's not only about that, it's also about having business opportunities in your organization to be able to reach out to your customers and build trust with them, right? For example, a customer is calling to the bank and saying, why my loan has been rejected? And the bank can reply to them, because from our feature importance from the model, we can tell that you are not married and the occupation is admin, right? So let me just give you some ideas that the call center can be enhanced with technology like that in order to explain why a model gave that prediction for that particular customer. Yeah, so this is a business opportunity, not just a compliance matter.
Ask, I just want to make sure I really understand what's going on here. So the request you have in line 43, so you sent one instance, right? So this is the features, right? The features of the instance. And you want to get a prediction and then also get explanation.
Right. So yes, exactly. I could do here just predict. And let me send the request. And I'm getting back just the prediction, like we have seen in the MLOps dataset. I've sent this vector of values, the age these of the car. Yeah, this is the age. They are 39 and they are female or something. And they get 2,000 per month. Or sorry, this is not a feature. There is a list. This is a public data set. I don't remember it by heart. But the point is that you get a prediction back from the predict. But if you want to get an explanation, you can change this to explain, and it will route it to the explainer that you have defined, your inference service. And then the explainer is going to give you back all of this information based on the explainer that you have chosen when you defined your model. So here you have a predictor with a model, scikit-learn, and then an explainer with a technology that is supporting your explanation and the particular algorithm that this technology supports. Yeah. So here you can have alibi, or you can have, let's say, AIX. You can have alibi or AIX 360 or AIF. Yeah. For explainer, this is not the option. But you get the point. It gives you one common interface to define your now enriched model serving platform, because now we are talking about a model serving platform and not anymore about a model server. So you have things around your model serving. It's the transformer to do the transformation, is the explainer to do the explanation, the fairness and the robustness is maybe the transformer that is going to fetch features from your feature store. We can see later.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick question about this alibi. I haven't used it. Do you need to train this as well, or it works just for any model?
It works out of the box with some models. Okay. but there are also some custom implementations for your custom models. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so like if we use something from scikit-learn, like something standard, like I don't know, decision trees or linear model, then it knows how to
get
these anchors, right?
Go to the I can ask everyone. They can go to the website of Trusted AI in Linux Foundation or LFAI in data or in GitHub and see all these algorithms that they have in place for these tools. So you can not only choose the anchor tabular or the anchor images, you can also choose other nice algorithms for fairness or for explanation, even for adversarial robustness. That was recently used to hack the iPhone neural hash. How was it called? Yeah. So it gives you back the L2 error directly, and in that case, it's so nice explanation, but it's actually an experiment to do a robustness check in your model. So it's handling it as a black box and is sending different images to that classifier. Let me show you the definition. Art. So this art server is using the art explainer and is using the square attack method. So this is, if you remember, you have stop signs on the street and you can just put some stickers to trick the prediction mechanism of a Tesla to think that this stop sign is not a stop sign. Yeah. And so the square attack, what is doing, this method is just putting squares on a picture randomly and sending the request to the model to find out which location of these boxes can get the wrong predictions. So essentially it's finally getting, although the prediction was for the digit 3, it has managed to get the prediction for digit 9. So it sent multiple requests to achieve that and things like that. So this is the art explainer, the adversarial robustness toolbox.
Yeah, interesting. Thank you.
Yeah. Finally, I have this integration with FIST in my list because, and also with HopsWorks. There are multiple feature stores, and now there is an evolution of them to embedding stores because we like to store embeddings of our models in a feature store, right? So, what the feature stores are offering is the ability to enrich your payload request with extra features. For example, we have this example of drivers in this sample. And these are the IDs of drivers that will deliver food for our food delivery business, right? And we want to know which of the five drivers do we choose to make this delivery. But I don't have other features other than, I don't have any features, I only have the IDs of the drivers. But if I will send this request to the model, it will tell me, yeah, go with this driver because this is getting the best score in whatever I have used in my features. And the question is, what extra features have you got, right? So now it's when it comes to the space of logging and how we can see things around logging. So I have here in my, I have a Kibana with Elasticsearch installed in the same cluster. And just I can-
Quick question. So
yes,
you have key serving running on your laptop, then you have TensorFlow serving, then you have FIST running there, and now you're saying that you also have Kibana and I guess Elasticsearch.
Yeah, I can quickly show you here. I have.
How is it possible to run so many things? That...
It's not. It's like 5-6 models, the art server, the German credits, etc. And I have a FIST instance that is running locally. Uh-huh. And an Elasticsearch, it's an Elasticsearch as a service in Kubernetes, and the Kibana instance. And they do not really take a lot of space. It's,
for FIST, it's quite light, right? I thought it's heavier, like you need a lot of...
Right, so this is only running a local server. It's not running the full Spark cluster with JVM instances and the Redis behind the Get Online features. It's only running the local interface.
Yeah, got it.
Yeah. But I did run it in order to have it available for this sample. And what I have done is I have in my models, let me go to FIST. In my predictor, I have enabled logging, yeah? And in my transformer, I have also enabled logging. So now I have two components in my inference service called driver. So you can see here in my pods, I have a pod called transformer and the pod called, is it the one with the driver? Oh, here I have a pod called transformer and the pod called predictor, yeah? So what we can do is we can look at the payload logging in the last search. Maybe actually, let's take a step back. Let's remember from last year what we have enabled here. I have in the samples directory the drift detection example with a nice maybe architecture. Yeah. So this architecture image shows that from an inference service, I can enable logger, and this will send the events as knative eventing events in a bus, yeah, in a broker that we can have then subscribers collect these events in a data-driven environment, imagine. And then you can build modules like outlier detection or adversarial detection that are subscribed to this broker in order to retrieve events like inferences that are taking place in order to alert, for example, trigger a retraining loop or say to the data scientist that we have a lot of drift in the concept, that we have a lot of drift in the classes. Yeah. So the concept drift, for example, is when your class distribution is changing over time. So because of the data are changing, your classes might change. There is a new iPhone released and there is suddenly a new class, or in the existing classes, there is more volume arriving. So how can we see that? Yeah. So what I have done is I created a trigger to send them events to an Elasticsearch in my cluster. And that's what I'm just gonna show you, how nicely I can see in the last 15 minutes, my requests, and can see what is the inference service name, for example, that has sent and received a request. This is, I can see the component. Yeah, this is the predictor, this is the transformer that has received the request. This is the predictor that has received the request. I can see also the request and also the output, yeah, the prediction. So it's nicely shown. That's what we call the payload logging. So in the case of driver, I've sent the array of the 5 driver IDs, yeah, remember, but to the transformer. But what actually happened, the transformer connected to FIST, got all the extra features that I defined in my model, in my transformer, and built this more expressive feature table. Let me see it in the JSON here, it's nicely. Yeah, so instead of showing just the driver IDs, it's also showing some other features, like how many trips the driver has done that particular day, how many trips the driver have done today, in order to choose that driver as the optimal because of the number of trips was lower than the others, for example, or whatever are the other features meaning here. Let me remind you here, if I go to the model definition, that I define the FIST serving URL, the entity IDs that will send driver IDs, and the 3 features that I wanted to fetch from my feature store. So the average daily trips and some other values. Yeah. So instead of the next request, if it will retrieve also the driver ID for a comparison, it will not go to my backend database to fetch features. It will go directly to the online store to do the FIST fetch online feature from my Redis and quickly give back the answer. So eventually, we create a caching mechanism in front of our dataset, and this is magnificent. Similarly, with HopsWorks, you have the function to fetch the vector from the online store of HopsWorks. And this is brilliant because you can actually achieve that. How was it here in the data plane? The transformer is connecting to FIST, fetches the, enriches the request, and sends the request to the predictor to get back a prediction. Yeah. And since, but we want low latency here. So that's why the transformer is going to the whatever is the online store of FIST, the Redis-based key value store.
Can you show how we all got questions?
Yes, please.
Can you show real fast how you created that trigger?
Sure. Yeah. Cloud events. I use the cloud events system and the cloud events library and the Elasticsearch library. I have it handy here. So it's actually loading the Elasticsearch config. I'm saying connect to this Elasticsearch, and maybe I can increase the font size.
Oh, thank you.
connecting to this Elasticsearch, and then for whatever for the data that is getting from the cloud event, it's called cloud events, by the way. Cloud event is an abstraction, let's say, of the cloud provider event mechanism. So, for example, AWS has CloudWatch, and Azure has something else, and Google has something else. Instead of learning the library of each individual cloud provider, you get this nice library called cloud events that is asking everyone else to be compliant with it. Yeah. So you define the cloud event. It looks like this. Yeah. It's just how it's serialized. You have the data and you have some headers. Yeah. This is a cloud event. So I'm sending this cloud event that I've got from my broker to this to the index of this Elasticsearch. I called it logs in that case. So it was like 10, 20 lines of code to create this trigger. Yeah. Not this trigger, to create the container that is fetching stuff from this broker and saves it to Elasticsearch.
Did I because correctly yeah. that so you have all these logs, you have the predictor, you have the transformer, you have the what else you have like this thing, all of them write logs, all of them emit log like these cloud events, right? They put these events to some sort of what's it called, broker, like to some sort of message queue.
Yes, it's like a message queue. It's not stored, but you can choose what channel you can have here. I'm using the memory channel in my laptop, but in your case, you might want to have a Kafka.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you put to some broker, and then there is something that reads from this stream, right? Reads from Kafka or reads from memory and does something. In this particular case, you just showed us this Elasticsearch trigger that reads from this broker and then puts the logs in Elasticsearch, right? And this is what we saw when you showed us the
yes. logs. It's a K-native eventing thing. So I can do get brokers, and I will see the list of brokers that I have. I have only created one broker, which is the default ingress broker. And I also have the trigger. And in the case of trigger, I created this Elasticsearch trigger to say that I want to subscribe to the default broker and send all the data to my Elasticsearch. Yeah. And then because the data that are inferred from our models is the treasure of my organization, right? We have the data from our customers, and then we hit models and we get new data, new information. This new information is what we have produced. This is the IP of our company. The models are the IP of our company, and the data that we have produced is treasure. Doesn't make sense to lose it and just return it to the customer and forget. We want to reuse them in order to retrain maybe our models, to see the distributions nicely. Let me see. What was the model that we were using earlier before this? The art server. Yeah, let's pick up the art server. If I will filter for this value and only see the data for this art server, I can look at the predictions. And I've got some predictions for 3 and some predictions for 9 digit. Yeah. So I can nicely see from Elasticsearch the distributions, either through the UI or programmatically by invoking the Elasticsearch SDK. You can also visualize it and see the, how to say here, predictions. And I can see the distributions of the classes. Actually, this is the class distribution, what we call it fans in academia, concept drift. Yeah. So you can store this distribution periodically, maybe every day or every hour, and then compare the one distribution with the other. There are mechanisms to compare. TFDV, for example, TensorFlow data validation comes with a nice library, either using L-infinity distance, to compare the class distribution. To compare features that are categorical, or you can use the Shannon distance, the Shannon divergence to compare numerical features. Yeah. So in our case, this is categorical. So I would use the one line code here of TFDV to do the skew comparator with L infinity norm and get a threshold back. And if this threshold is above the level that I'm used to, then I will alarm that I have skew in my, I have concept drift. I have new distribution in my classes.
Do you have something else in your agenda? Because I'm not sure if I should ask more about login, or what else do you want to cover?
Yeah, I'm also running the Prometheus backend if you want to see it, but I don't know if it makes sense. It's very straightforward thing that the DevOps people are using, and they have it in Grafana with nice visualizations of how many requests you have got per model and what is the latency per model. But these are straightforward things now that we call service monitoring, right? And I wouldn't bother you with this. So let's go to your questions.
Yeah, so the question I have is, like, speaking about logging. So sometimes, for example, at 2 weeks, when we deal with image models, so we have, I don't know, let's say 6 image models, and each of these image models gets 10 million requests per day, 10 million images per day. And then in the examples you have here, you send them in Base64 or something like this. And if we start logging this, will it not explode quickly? Like, if for 6 different models we log everything, then our Elasticsearch cluster will just,
Oh, you mean here in Elasticsearch, what was this view? What was it?
Not necessarily view, but in general, like, we need to store this data somewhere. Like,
do we really need to? It would appear here, which would be too much, right?
Yeah,
to have the full Base64.
Like, predictor is probably okay, like, because we want to maybe not the input, we still want to see the output to be able to detect the drift.
Yeah. So in that case, what would you do? You wouldn't like to log the predictor request, right?
Yeah, not request.
Yeah.
The response, I think, is useful because you can detect the like this.
Yeah, because you are getting the URL, and you only want to log the URL. Yeah, let me show here in the models where I have the logger. Yeah, so I'm logging here all. So I'm logging everything. But if I would change that, I can also log the response or the request.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it makes sense. In your case, you wouldn't like to log the request. Not for the transformer, but for the
For the actual
predictor.
Yeah.
So here, in the case of OLX, you would say, I want only to log the response. And this will not log in Elasticsearch the request. I have other examples of other businesses that would only like to log the request, the response of the transformer, and not the response of the predictor, because it's similar, right? Actually, it's the same. Mm-hmm. Or maybe you would not like to log the request of the transformer, because the transformer is getting a full Base64, but it doesn't make sense to log it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah? Exactly. Yeah. If I send a URL to the transformer, so transformer fetches the image, does this all resizing, and then sends NumPy array to the predictor, right? So in this case, maybe login URL is okay, right? Because then we can just go to logs and see, okay, this is the URL. But for the predictor, we don't want to see the NumPy array, right?
Exactly. This is exactly what it is the case with image models. Eh? But it's the opposite with text-based models, the NLP models. Because for NLP, you get a long text, let's say a paragraph or a full text that you want to classify as let's say as bad content, for example, if you are Stack Overflow or Wikipedia, and you want to do some type of classification about the content that your users are submitting. Your NLP model will receive a huge body, but you don't want to log it. You just want to log the features of it. And your transformer will fetch the request from, it will fetch the data from whatever library is there, and then it will do the tokenization. It will break it into tokens and then send all of the tokens to your predictor. Yeah. Maybe it will fetch also the from the embedding store, from the feature store, it will fetch the embeddings for these tokens and send the request to the predictor to just do the k-means or the KNN to minimize the distance and detect whether it belongs to one class or the other. Thanks. Nice that my color has changed.
So I'm wondering about the tool. So you're using Kibana right now. Do you feel like they're
is a time where you should use a specific monitoring tool that is made for machine learning? Or is it good enough just with what you get like from Prometheus and Grafana or Kibana?
I would love to have such a tool, but I'm not aware of any tool like that. I know there are some vendors who are building on top of that, and they are actually active in the community, in the MLOps community. But I am not familiar with any open source tool that is focused on the area of monitoring machine learning models. But that would be great to have, maybe as a sub-project of KServe.
Yeah, there is evidently, but I don't know how well they integrate with the whole Kubeflow ecosystem.
Yeah, I was thinking about evidently also as the open source one. There was another one that I can't remember right now. What My exactly? Ops? Aporia, I'm not sure if they're open source though. That's the only thing.
Yeah, there's Ylogs from
Lobo. Oh, Ylogs. Are they open source though?
I don't think the logs part, yes. The visualization, I think it's on matched.
Yeah, so it's a really interesting one with the monitoring, because a lot of people that I've talked to have just said use whatever like you're used to using. Use the Prometheus and Grafana because it's good enough and it does it. But then you have 20 different monitoring tools that have come out in the last year, right? So they're trying to tackle the problem, but it's interesting that you say you haven't seen anything yet that has done it up to your liking and open source.
Right. But the community has also recognized that, and we would like to build such a tool, or we would like to adopt such a tool and integrate it with the ecosystem of Kubeflow.
Yeah. So you got anything else for us, or is that it? Is there anything?
Actually, there was a recent contribution from a community member who created also UI for KServe. So in Kubeflow now, you can have models. So you can see the list of your models in your UI. And when you click on a model, you can see also the Grafana dashboard metrics, like number of requests and the latency. It was Kimonas from Aricto who did this contribution. Oh, wow. And that was significant for the project.
That's awesome.
I have a quick question. I am really it's really cool that you got all these things running locally, because I remember when I was experimenting with Kubeflow serving, because it was a real pain to do things locally. So what I ended up doing was just creating an IKEA server and experimenting there. And you can imagine debugging things in such a way is a nightmare. So I'm really curious about your setup. How did you do this locally?
It's quite lightweight nowadays, and not only KFServing and KServe, but also Kubeflow itself. I'm using Kind to load the cluster as a Docker image, and that takes 1 gigabyte of memory. And then the full-blown Kubeflow installation on top of it is another 6 gigabytes. So with 7 gigabytes, you have Docker on top of this, you have Kind on top of this, you have Kubeflow and everything else. The UI and the models and the KTIP library and Kubeflow pipelines.
A low number or high? Because I'm not sure, 7 gigs, like it's basically the entire memory.
That's the memory that it takes for the Kubernetes cluster with the Kubeflow on top of Docker. Mm-hmm. Then if you will start loading models, based on the number of models that you load, you have more memory consumption, of course.
And with this Kind, it's possible, as I understood, to only have KServe, right, without a lot of other stuff.
Yes, most of the businesses are using KServe without Kubeflow, yeah, because it doesn't make sense to have for your production environment a full-blown Kubeflow. Yeah.
Okay. Because for notebooks, we don't use notebooks. Pipelines also not so much.
Yeah, that was what was kind of fascinating. It seemed like the natural next step for, like, that's why I understood KFServing became KServe, right? Because it feels like it's one of those things that lots of people want to just use on their own, as opposed to bringing all of Kubeflow with it. And I know that you could do that before, though, right? Like,
right. It has nothing to do new. With it has nothing to do with a separate organization.
Yeah, yeah. But maybe it's just now...
KServe was always available also as a standalone implementation.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah. We love the Kubeflow community, and all the people there are very helpful. And we work together for the manifest project that is integrating all the components of Kubeflow actually into what is called Kubeflow.
If anybody has not figured it out by now, Theo is the biggest Kubeflow fan in the world. If you have any questions about Kubeflow, normally when they come through the MLOps community Slack, I tag him in it and say, oh, my daughter wants to jump in. So if you have anything that you want to talk Kubeflow about and you're not getting answers in the Kubeflow community, Theo might be the guy to hit up on the MLOps community Slack or just on the Kubeflow community Slack. I think that's all the time we got, man. This has been really cool. I enjoy learning from you. I really enjoy seeing where KServe is going and all these new updates. The fairness part is especially interesting for me. I think that's an excellent add-on, and I hope to see that mature more and more as time goes on. And yeah, it's great to have you just teaching us. And Alexey, I cannot thank you enough for these questions that you're asking. They've been super helpful for me to have an understanding and help slow down Theo when he's going super fast and just expecting us to know everything. So I appreciate the both of you being on here.
Thanks for inviting.
Thanks a lot.
All right, everybody. We'll see you later. This was fun. Thanks for joining us. And if you are watching this in the future on YouTube, give us a like and a subscribe or whatever cool people do on YouTube. That's it. We'll see you.
Yeah, you forgot about the bell.
And the bell. Alexey's a pro. You see, he's the pro. All right, see ya.
Goodbye.